Hello. Let me swoop on down and see who's there. Who? Hello. I'm Thurston Owl the Third. Today, we're talking about Lazarus. When Jesus' friend Lazarus died, Jesus used his power to bring him back to life again. Today, we will learn that God has the power to provide for all of our needs. Isn't that a hoot? Oh, and happy Father's Day to all you dads out there. Ta-ta.
Hey there, everybody. Happy Father's Day. In honor of Father's Day, I've got a few dad jokes for you. How does a penguin build its house? It glues it together. Glues it back. What do you call a man who can't stand? Neil. Why did the scarecrow win in the war? Because he was outstanding in his field. What do you call a bear without any teeth? A gummy bear. I had a dream I was a muffler last night. I woke up exhausted. What does an annoying pepper do? It gets jalapeno face. All right, well, I'll catch you later, everybody. Hope you enjoy the service.
Check out this old Father's Day video we just pulled out of our children's ministry vault.
What do you two want?
Hey, Dad, it's your son, Luke.
And me, his twin sister.
So we've been thinking about what happened recently, and listen, we're really sorry.
We're really sorry, Dad.
We're sorry we blew up your Death Star.
It was a really nice Death Star.
It was really nice.
We had no right to blow it up.
It was wrong, and we know that.
I mean, you blew up my whole planet with it, but it was your Death Star.
And we're not supposed to touch Dad's things.
So, we're very sorry.
Sorry about shooting all those stormtroopers, too.
Oh, yeah. Sorry about that, too.
They were only doing their jobs trying to shoot us.
Because we were trespassing.
And even though they were shooting at us.
And even though they never came close to actually hitting us.
We're very sorry.
Okay.
Sorry about shooting all your stormtroopers, Dad.
Oh, and one more thing. Sorry about the droids.
What about the droids?
Well, Dad was looking for the droids, and I told him they weren't the droids he was looking for.
You lied to Dad?
Well, it was old Ben that lied, and he lied to the stormtroopers, and they were Dad's stormtroopers, and I didn't correct him.
Oh. Sorry, Dad.
Sorry.
Ungrateful kids.
Sorry we're such rebels.
Please forgive us.
You have to forgive us.
It's what dads do.
Don't you remember the prodigal son's father, Dad?
He forgave his rebellious son.
Please forgive your little rebel princess.
And your rebel son.
Okay.
Aw, thanks, Dad. See you at the picnic.
Yeah, see you at the picnic.
I'm bringing casserole.
And I'm bringing blue milk.
We love you, Dad.
Love you.
Bye. Bye. Love you.
Isn't technology wonderful? It has put everything in the palm of our hand. It has taken a simple invention, like a telephone, and turned it into something so much more. We don't have phones anymore. We have pocket-sized computers. Have a question? Just look it up. You can look up trivia, movie reviews, directions, the weather, and even history facts, and anything else you can think of. Smartphones can do a lot, but they can only do so much. A smartphone can tell you how to cook, but it can't give you food. It can teach you how to make money, but it can't make you money. A phone can't give you shelter, clothes, or love. It may seem like a pretty smart invention, but there's only so much it can do. We don't need phones to give us everything we need, because if we have Jesus, we have the source of all things good. God knows our needs before we even ask. He knows what's in our hearts, and he knows the things that we need most. It's a joy to him when we ask for things in prayer. And he loves to hear our praise when we thank him for his provision. God knows our needs before we can even ask. And unlike a smartphone, God can actually provide those needs. So let's thank God for all the blessings and the love that he shares with us every day.
Today, we are talking about how God is our provider. Many times, we refer to God as our Father. Our earthly fathers also provide for us. But unlike God, we have to put up with their bad jokes. In this competition, Drew and Daniel will take turns reading each other's bad dad jokes. Make your opponent laugh, and you get a point. Highest score wins. Let's go.
Hey, what did the drummer call his twin daughters? And a one and a two. When does a joke become a dad joke? When it becomes a parent. Man, I don't trust stairs. They're always up to something. I made a pencil with two erasers. It was pointless. Two goldfish are in a tank. One says to the other, "Hey, do you know how to drive this thing?" Did you hear about the circus fire? It was tense. What did the janitor say when they jumped out of the store cupboard? Supplies! Did you hear the rumor about the butter? I'm not gonna spread it. What do you call someone with no body and no nose? Nobody knows. Did you hear about the kidnapping at school? It's fine, you woke up. So good. It's very good. What did the horse say after it tripped? Help! I've fallen and I can't. Giddy up! What's brown and sticky? A stick. What do you call a fish with two knees? A toony fish. Want to hear a joke about paper? Never mind. It's terrible. Why was the belt sent to jail? For holding up a pair of pants. My friend keeps on saying, "Cheer up, man, it could be worse. You could be stuck underground in a hole full of water." I know he means well. What kind of shoes do ninjas wear? What kind? I don't know, maybe sneakers? What do you call a hippie's wife? Mississippi. Fair game, fair game.
It is time to memorize our Bible verse for this lesson. And as you can tell, it's a short verse. And if you've been watching, we've had this same verse now for 4 weeks. So what does that mean? It means you can memorize this verse. And once you have this verse memorized, send me a video, email it, Facebook, text it to me, somehow give me that video, or show up at my doorstep. recite the verse. Or stop me on the street if you see me somewhere. Recite this verse and you can win a box of cereal. I've got a lot of boxes of cereal I need to give out, so I need you to win a box. Let's go through this verse right now. Now, it's a short verse, but we've got some motions to help you. And here's how the motions go. It says, my children, come, listen to me. I will teach you to have respect for the Lord. And that comes from the book of Psalm, chapter 34, verse 11. Memorize that verse.
From above, and you supply my every need. Your thoughts on me are love.
You're my provider, Jehovah Jireh, and you will cover every need. You're my provider, Jehovah Jireh, and I know you care about me.
You know my worries, you know my cares. As I look to you, yeah, this is true. Those worries disappear. Gift comes from above, and you supply my every need. Your thoughts on me are love.
You're my provider, Jehovah Jireh, and you will cover every need. You're my provider, Jehovah Jireh, and I know you care about me.
You care about me. All right, now bring it down.
You're my provider, Jehovah Jireh.
People in spooky campfire stories are usually missing a few things. Specifically, they lack the items that they need to help them escape those spooky woods, or the scary old house, or the haunted campsite, or the mad scientist's lab. And it seems like we should feel sorry for the kids who end up in the wrong place without the tools they need to help them to survive, but it's kind of their fault, isn't it? I mean, shouldn't kids who are headed into some scary woods with a haunted house bring along some things like flashlights, pocket knives, maybe a working cell phone, maybe some extra gas for their car? I certainly hope people don't camp in real life like the characters in campfire stories. Imagine going into the woods without a compass or a pan to fry your food in, or hooks and bait for fishing, or flashlights, or even a map. A little thought and planning ahead of time could save you a lot of trouble, especially if you wandered into some haunted woods. Now, one of the things that people discovered about Jesus is that he didn't bring along much of anything when he traveled. He didn't need to. Neither did the people that he was with. If Jesus saw a need, he was able to meet that need. There was never a moment when Jesus said, if I had only thought to bring along some food. Because Jesus found a boy's lunch and made food for 5,000 people. And Jesus never said, sorry man, I forgot the medicine. Because Jesus reached out his hand and he healed the sick. Jesus turned water into wine. He gave sight to the blind. He even gave the disabled the ability to walk. But was there a limit to what he could do? Was there a limit to Jesus' power? On one of the saddest days of his life, Jesus showed us once and for all that he has the power to do anything. Today's story happened on the day that Jesus went to his friend Lazarus' funeral. Check out the story from John, chapter 11, verses 17 to 45.
When Jesus arrived, he found out that Lazarus had already been dead in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. Many Jews had come to Martha and Mary. They had come to comfort them because their brother was dead. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed inside. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "I wish you had been here, then my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you anything you ask for." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again. This will happen when people are raised from the dead on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live, even if they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God. I believe that you are the one who was supposed to come into the world." After she said this, she went back home. She called her sister Mary to one side to talk to her. "The teacher is here," Martha said. "He is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Jesus had not yet entered the village. He was still at the place where Martha had met him. Some Jews had been comforting Mary in the house. They noticed how quickly she got up and went out, so they followed her. They thought she was going to the tomb to mourn there. Mary reached the place where Jesus was. When she saw him, she fell at his feet. She said, "Lord, I wish you had been here, that my brother would not have died." Jesus saw her crying. He saw that the Jews who had come along with her were also crying. His spirit became very sad and he was troubled. "Where have you put him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how much he loved him." But some of them said, "He opened the eyes of the blind man. Couldn't he have kept this man from dying?" Once more, Jesus felt very sad. He came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone in front of the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad smell. Lazarus has been in the tomb for 4 days. Then Jesus said, "Didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up. He said, "Father, thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here. I said it so they will believe that you sent me." Then Jesus called in a loud voice. He said, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out. His hands and feet were wrapped with strips of linen, a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the clothes he was buried in and let him go." Many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary saw what Jesus did, so they believed in him.
Lazarus was a dear friend of Jesus. He and his sisters, Mary and Martha, appear frequently in the gospel stories. Jesus often stayed at their house when he was in town, and they always took good care of Jesus. They always took care of Jesus' needs. And Mary and Martha desperately wanted Jesus to come and heal their sick brother, just like he'd healed so many other people. And they couldn't understand why it took him so long to come. And eventually Lazarus died, and they buried him in a tomb. And it was the way that Jesus wanted it to be. No, Jesus did not want his friend to die, but Jesus knew that his friend's death would be an opportunity to demonstrate his power. And so Jesus spoke, and Lazarus rose from the grave. And Jesus used that to show us that there is no limit to what he can do. Whatever needs you have, Jesus can meet it. Now, it's very important that we remember the difference between a need and a want. See, wants are things that we like, but we don't need. Things like candy and toys and fancy new bicycles. Needs are things that we can't live without, such as water, oxygen, and food. Now, Jesus is not a cosmic grandpa up in heaven with a fat wallet and a vending machine who will give us whatever we want. He's not there to answer our prayers for candy bars and new bikes and new houses. Jesus wants us to rely on him for our daily bread, the things that we need every day. Jesus wants us to ask for these things in his name, and when we pray for them, God will provide. When we give our needs to God and God answers our prayer, our faith grows. We learn to pray more and to trust more, knowing that God is going to give us those needs. Relying on God for our needs is also a way to share God's love with the world. When the world sees God move in our lives, they'll know that he is real. When they see how much God loves us, they'll want that for themselves. They'll crave that for themselves. We don't need to wish on the stars for what we need. We have a God watching over us who already knows what we need. Give your needs to God, share them with him, and ask him to provide. The more you do, the easier it will be to see God in action, providing what we need and giving us our daily bread, just like he gave Lazarus back to his family. God knows your needs before you even ask. Ask, and you will receive. Everyone, thank you so much for watching. Happy Father's Day. I'll catch you back here next week. We are at the end of another service. And at the end of each service, we give out a digital badge. and we want to see how many of these you can collect. Each of these badges remind us and can help us to remember the stories that we've already talked about. Because on each badge, there's a picture. This week's badge looks like this. What does that picture remind you of from today's story? Why did we pick that one?